So he may fail, as he buys more fame and glory, still he tries in each new story tale. Let's head and meet Tuxedo and his tail.
This is Mark Arnold, animation historian and author of the book created and produced by Total Television Productions. And today I'm speaking with Buck Biggers, who is one of the founders and creators of Total Television Productions and Tennessee Tuxedo. And he's a co-author of the book How Underdog Was Born with another co-creator, Chet Stover. So this was the 70th and final episode of Tennessee Tuxedo, and the show had debuted in September 28, 1963 on CBS, and had been running for 3 years. It was very popular on the networks, and after 3 seasons, the show was suddenly canceled. Why did the series conclude at this time?
General Mills had a policy with their shows, with their different series, of ordering enough for 3 full years. They felt that children changed age brackets in that time, and the age bracket they were after would be fulfilled in 3 years. So a particular type of show or a particular series like Tennessee Tuxedo, they only ordered 3 years worth, and our 3 years were up. Now there were inner series that, like The Hunter, which were many more episodes, were ordered simply because they could be used and shifted around from one series to the other.
Is that the reason why The Hunter originally appeared on King Leonardo and then appeared on this show?
Correct.
So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the voice cast on this episode, namely D'Lo States. And as you can see here, she is the voice of Samantha in this episode, but she also did a number of voices, basically all the female voices over at Total Television, except for Sweet Polly Purebred, who was done by Norman MacMillan. Why was that?
Amazing, isn't it? Every voice except Sweet Polly Purebred.
I know very little about her, so do you know more about her and tell me what other things she's done?
She was a stage actress. She was very good. She never particularly got very friendly with anybody, but she would just simply come in when she was due for her voice work, do it marvelously, flawlessly, never had any, very little direction, and just knew what she was supposed to do and did it. We didn't have nearly as many women in the series, girls, women, whatever, as we would have liked at that time. It just was not the thing to do. We had to fight to get Sweet Polly Purebred in the Underdog series.
By this third season of Tennessee Tuxedo and His Tales, you were also in production with The Underdog Show. And this is the first and the only time in Total Television's history that you had two different series in production. And I was wondering if there was any difficulties in having two different series in production at the exact same time.
I think as a general rule, certainly it was for us, it was a marvelous thing to have. And no matter how much fun, and we did have fun, we should have paid to do this work. It was so much fun for Chet Stover and I. No matter how much fun it is, there does come a time when suddenly you'll say to yourself, I just don't think I can figure another way to go here. I've done this over and over and over. And when you've got another type of show to shift to between, say, Tennessee and Underdog, It's a wonderful relief. It makes you able to come back to the other show with fresh eyes and a fresh heart.
Tennessee Tuxedo had a couple supporting segments such as Tudor Turtle and The Hunter. They both originally appeared on King Leonardo and his short subjects. I was just wondering if you could tell me a little bit about those segments, especially The Hunter.
He was one of the very first ideas that we had, and it just couldn't be lengthened to anything longer. We felt it was a one-joke cartoon. I don't mean a one-joke series. I mean each episode was one thing. You're going to steal a trumpet, you're going to steal the bridge, you're going to steal something. But there was just, you know, one thing for each episode. So we didn't feel it could be lengthened. I had always loved Kenny Delmar's impressions that he did on the Fred Allen show. And one of those characters was a Southerner who would say things like, that's a joke, son, and I only drink out of Dixie cups, you know. He was a lovable character, and the idea to use him in a series was just wonderful. So we got the idea that he would be a detective, and the fox would be his villain, and he would steal something, and the hunter would, in the most absurd way possible, end up capturing the fox. And that's what happened. And it was a wonderful kind of plot, just so much fun to dream up and do. We loved them. We did more, I think, of those than any single series we had. And they were fun to do. And Kenny Delmar proved to be the voice himself, and he was a wonder to have around.
He continued on this series because he was the narrator, and he also did a couple other characters.
Oh, God, he could do anything, too. He was great. We just had wonderful people to work with, people like Alan Swift, who did our first series, and they were just great voice people who would just come in and do what you tell them, and like it was nothing.
You mentioned Alan Swift, and we also talked about Tudor Turtle. I was wondering if you could elaborate and tell me a little bit more about the history behind that show. I know it's a segment that has Tudor Turtle always wanting to be somebody that he isn't, and he goes to see Mr. Wizard. So what was the basic premise behind that series?
Well, that was one that you couldn't help but love because it was your own life. How many times have all of us dreamed about being something we're not, something we'd long to be? Anything from a king to an airplane pilot to a detective, FBI, local cop, anything. And Tudor Turtle, who was about as imperfectly fixed up to be one of those things as anybody you could meet, wanted to be all of them. Each week he wanted to be something else he shouldn't have wanted to be. And Mr. Wizard the Lizard would simply help him get there by saying magic words that let Tudor Turtle head out into the unknown. And it took 4.5 minutes for him to find out that, my God, please, Mr. Wizard, please, Mr. Wizard, get me out of here. And then it was drizzle, 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 drone. Time for this fun to come home.
Could you tell me about your co-creators of Total Television that worked with you all these years, namely Chet Stover, Tred Covington, and Joe Harris?
Well, if you're ever trapped on a desert island, Chet's the man to be with. He can do it all, make you feel happy, and keep you feeling optimistic. And, of course, I had to make him feel optimistic sometimes, but nevertheless, he's very good at it. And he's just a creative genius, and he and I just were a wonderful team, and I couldn't have picked a better partner if I'd looked a million years.
And then let me know about Tred Covington.
Tred I've known for 100 years. He came up and met his girlfriend in my apartment and got some kind of thing, I don't know what scarlet fever, what it is, and couldn't leave the apartment for for 2 weeks. So I'll never forget that meeting. We talked about doing 100 things before I ever got to Total Television Productions. But when I got there and needed somebody who could really handle a company in New York, while Chet and I took off for worlds unknown, Tred was the man, and he was great at it. He's also great in the studio, great with people, just terrific, terrific addition.
Could you tell me a little bit more about Joe Harris?
I don't know anybody who could have done the job he did. I don't know anybody else. We thought of somebody else at the time, but I doubt that they could have handled it. Joe was just absolutely marvelous. He worked hours that you wouldn't believe and did everything we asked him to do. Just tremendous.
Well, Buck, I want to thank you for joining me today. I just want to remind you that this was the final episode of Tennessee Tuxedo called Samantha.
Thanks so much.
Come on and see, Tennessee Tuxedo. See, Tennessee Tuxedo. Tennessee Tuxedo and his tail.